वेल गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, गुड मॉर्निंग एंड रियली आई एम थैंकफुल टू डॉक्टर अनुज महेश्वरी, डॉक्टर नरसिंह वर्मा, डॉक्टर जयंत पांडा, the chairman of the scientific committee for inviting me in this beautiful venue and great hospitality. In the next 15 minutes or so, I am going to talk about dengue fever atypical manifestations. I have divided my talk in two parts. The first part, we would like to revise the typical manifestation as such. It's better to revise whatever we know. And then in the second part, I'll go for the atypical manifestations there. Well, so for the revision part, yes, dengue, the disease, we know that it's an infection of the tropical and subtropical regions. Our country also falls in that region. That is why dengue fever is so common in our country as well. It's non-specific febrile illness and can lead to even fatal hemorrhagic disease. And that is why increased morbidity and mortality that we witness so commonly in this disease process. We all know that it is caused by a virus and is spread by the mosquito. And this is also, we know that it's a RNA virus disease with the four serotypes of dengue 1, 2, 3, and 4, and the cycle involves human and mosquitoes. The infections with one virus gives the immunity to that serotype only. That is very, very important for us to know. And once the infection occurs because of the second serotype, then of course it becomes a little more complicated. The dengue virus, it belongs to virus flavivirus. The natural host of dengue virus is human and is transmitted by orthopod vectors, Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. Albopictus is a little less common, Aegypti is a little more common. Domestic day-biting mosquito preferred to feed on humans, and short flight range as well as breeds in the stored water. This is all we know about the disease process. And this mosquito may bite several people in the same household, and that is why even sometimes the whole family gets infected with this. Now, as far as the re-emerging infection or the epidemiology of the disease process is concerned, dengue hemorrhagic fever in Asia is very common. Particularly, the epidemics are noted in India, Sri Lanka, Maldives, and even Taiwan. The problem is that progressively larger epidemics after a few years again, this is a very common problem. And that is why the burden of the disease process is huge. Primarily, the urban population is a little more affected with this because of the uncontrolled urbanization and the population growth, the substandard housing, inadequate water, sewer or waste management. That is one of the main problems, and as well as ineffective mosquito control in the endemic regions, as well as hyperendemicity and the prevalence of multiple serotypes. These are the main points why this disease process has not been eradicated and is occurring again and again in the years to come. In India, the dengue was first isolated way back in 1945. There are many epidemics of dengue hemorrhagic fever as well as dengue shock syndrome, even in Delhi or Lucknow. All four serotypes are prevalent. The virus is prevalent all over except Himalayan region and Kashmir. So naturally, if you want to avoid this disease process, you will have to go to Kailash Parvat and to stay there. So as far as the global burden is concerned, the disease is estimated to be all over the tropics and subtropical regions. And the east southeast asian region contributes about more than 50% of the disease burden all over the world, and even India's contribution is even more than 35% or 34% of the 96 million apparent dengue virus infection, which is estimated to occur globally in 2010. In 2017, the data has shown that zero prevalence of dengue virus infection in India had gone even up to closing to 50% or so. As far as the seasonal variation is concerned, we know that this disease process is commonly highest during the monsoon period of the year, and it starts from June, July, and goes up to August, September, or October, with the maximum rate of positivity in August or September, which occurs to, you know, from more than 55% or so. So this is all about the incidence, global as well as Indian perspective as far as epidemiology is concerned. Now, if we go to pathophysiology of the disease process, the mosquito bite, which occurs at the skin, that cells of the skin are infected and they carry the dengue virus to the draining lymph nodes via the lymphs. There it starts the process, and then from the lymphs, the macrophages gets infected and they infect and carry the virus to the lymphatics and vascular vessels, which can lead to the spread of the virus in the bone marrows as well as in the spleen. From the spleen and bone marrows, even the Peyer's patches or lymph nodes get infected regional lymph nodes, and then even directly from the bone marrow, the lymph nodes of the region, they are affected as well as Peyer's patches. Now from here, from the Peyer's patches and lymph nodes, the dengue virus can spread to various organs like stomach, lungs, brain, liver, kidney, and heart. And it can cause even atypical or complicated manifestations of the disease process apart from the typical manifestations of the febrile illness. So the clinical features of the disease are that if we know that the clinical features of typical dengue fever are of the sudden onset of fever of the high grade with chills and rigors. Incubation period is around 2 to 7 days. Severe muscle aches, retroorbital pain, hepatomegaly, rash, facial flush, and fever subsides within 2 to 7 days, and even maybe by physical. The WHO classification of definition of dengue fever involves that the patient should have the acute febrile illness along with at least 2 or more of the following symptoms: headache, retroorbital pain, myalgia, arthralgia, and rashes. And if more than 2 symptoms of these are associated with febrile illness, it is most probably the case of dengue fever. If you want to confirm that it is a dengue fever, then demonstration of 4-fold or greater change in the reciprocal IgG or IgM antibody titer, that is immunological response of 1 or more dengue virus antigen in the paired serum sample, is needed for the confirmation of the case that it is a dengue fever only. Now, as WHO has classified the dengue fever infection, it has classified the typical dengue fever in asymptomatic or symptomatic one. With symptomatic, it can be undifferentiated viral syndrome, or once it is symptomatic, the dengue fever syndrome, it can be even with hemorrhage or without hemorrhage, with usual hemorrhage, or it can be a dengue hemorrhagic fever with a plasma leakage, where it can have a hemodynamically stable patient with no shock, or can have the hemodynamically instability with a decrease in blood pressure and tachycardia, tachypnea, which is called as dengue shock syndrome. So this is how the WHO has classified the dengue fever altogether. As far as the grading of severity of dengue infection is concerned, the WHO has divided the severity in 1, 2, 3, and 4 dengue hemorrhagic fever classes. This all depends upon the platelet count, which is less than 1 lakh, rise in hematocrit, which is more than 20%, along with the hemodynamic instability of circulatory failure, weak pulse, hypotension, or restlessness. The dengue hemorrhagic fever grade 3 and grade 4 are also called as dengue shock syndrome because of the instability of hemodynamic status of the patient with the increasing morbidity and mortality. So this was all about the epidemiology, the clinical features, as well as the classification of severity of the disease process of the typical dengue fever. Now, WHO criteria for the diagnosis of dengue hemorrhagic fever are, as I told you, that fever with hemorrhagic tendencies, with a thrombocytopenia of less than 1 lakh count, with the evidence of plasma leak, where the rise in hematocrit is more than 20%, as well as polycerocytes, where pleural effusion, ascites, or hypoproteinemias are also commonly seen. And similarly, the dengue shock syndrome is all the symptoms which are associated with circulatory failure of rapid weak pulse with a narrow pulse pressure of less than 20 millimeter of mercury, cold, clammy skin, restlessness, and even may present with abdominal pain, which can be mistaken for acute abdominal injury, and that is because of acalculus cholecystitis as well as polycerocytes. The immune response, as far as the investigation part is concerned, the primary infection shows the IgM antibody in the titer in the late acute or convalescent stage. Infection with one serotype does not protect against the other serotypes. NS1 detection test, NS1 antigen is a glycoprotein which appears early in the day 1 at the onset of the fever and declines by 5 to 6 days. IgM circulates and may be present there for even 3 to 4 months or even longer, but the fourfold or greater change in the antibody titer in the paired sera is pathognomic of diagnosing the case as dengue fever. So after this typical presentation, investigations, and the diagnosis and the criteria, I come to the atypical manifestations of the dengue fever, which is the old enemy in the new phase. The evaluation of the classification of WHO is that expanded dengue syndrome is typical of the presentation, which can increase the morbidity and mortality in these patients. So WHO has coined the term expanded dengue to describe the cases which do not fall in the typical presentations of the dengue fever or dengue shock syndrome or dengue hemorrhagic fever. So this expanded dengue syndrome is a typical, is atypical presentation in this season of what we are observing, and it is causing the increased mortality in these patients. So expanded dengue syndrome, that is again have the features of end organ damage, which can be because of the coagulation disorders, where it may be hemorrhage related, or even hypercoagulable state. The hypercoagulable state can cause even cerebral infarction, cortical venous thrombosis, or myocardial infarction. These expanded dengue syndrome can cause other organ damage. With co-infection, it can be a little more dangerous once it is associated with malaria, leptospirosis, enteric fever, or chikungunya. The dengue in high-risk cases like infants and geriatric and pregnancy causes more morbidity in these patients. So atypical manifestations are clubbed under expanded dengue syndrome, which can have the CNS manifestations in the form of intracerebral hemorrhage, encephalitis, cerebral infarct, myelitis, even Guillain-Barré syndrome, or even myalgia, pruritus, and whatnot. So there is a long list of CNS manifestation which can occur in an atypical manifestation of dengue. Similarly, GI and hepatic manifestations of hepatic dysfunction without acute liver failure, acalculus cholecystitis, which is very, very common, even acute pancreatitis or acute appendicitis also can present as atypical manifestations. The cardiovascular manifestations can be myocarditis, symptomatic or asymptomatic, maybe pericarditis, SA nodal block or AV nodal block, or acute atrial fibrillation,
or even cardiomyopathy. The renal manifestations are also very atypical manifestations of dengue, causing more of the morbid mortality, which can cause AKI associated with DHF or DSS, and hemolytic uremic syndrome, which is very fatal and increasing the mortality in these patients. The clinical evidences of atypical presentations, this is one paper from our own Era Medical College, Lucknow, and it has shown that out of 162 patients which were observed, even 42 patients had atypical manifestations of various organs. And apart from typical features like fever, headache, retroorbital or body ache, etc., certain atypical manifestations of dengue were seen, and these are not uncommon. This paper, again Indian paper, atypical manifestation of dengue fever, where do we stand? The conclusion of this paper was,
sorry to interrupt, 2 minutes more, sir.
Yeah, sure. Only hardly 4-5 slides. Some of the atypical manifestations of the dengue fever are no more a rare entity. This is seen nowadays. The atypical neurological manifestations of dengue fever, a case review which revealed that dengue virus can affect the nervous system at various targets using multiple mechanisms of pathogenesis to generate a plethora of presentations. Hence, it is vital to be aware of this presentation to be able to diagnose dengue and treat it accordingly, where the cause may be dengue and may cause encephalitis, acute motor axonal polyneuropathy, ocular flutter, myositis, and other problems of the central nervous system. Dengue induced acute kidney injury, which is a neglected but a fatal complications. In various studies which were published, it has shown that the incidence of acute kidney injury may vary from 10% to even 13% in various studies which were published. So acute kidney injury is also a very fatal complication of atypical nature in the dengue fever. The profile of liver function test in the patients with dengue and analysis of 27 serologically confirmed cases of dengue infection showed that around 90% of the cases had alteration in aminotransferase levels, with 37% which were categorized in grade B, 30% grade C, and 22% of grade D or acute hepatitis. So severe hepatic involvement is also not uncommon as atypical presentation. So liver damage with alteration of aminotransferase is the common complication of dengue infection and valuable marker for monitoring these patients. This is a paper which was published in Asia Pacific Journal of Tropical Medicine, that dengue fever presenting as acute liver failure, a 19-year-old male on examination, IgM body was found against dengue in serum. Liver function test showed predominantly conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, serum albumin was low, and final diagnosis was found to be dengue shock syndrome stage 4 with acute liver failure. So there are various presentations which are atypical of the dengue fever, and our literature is full of these presentations. This causes more of a damage and increased morbidity and mortality. So my last slide, that take home message is that dengue is burdensome viral infection in tropical regions like India during monsoon. Apart from the typical clinical features like fever, headache, retroorbital pain, and body ache, etc., certain atypical manifestation of dengue fever are being brought to the light. Atypical manifestation noted in dengue can be multisystemic and multifaceted. The clinical vigilance of these manifestations is important for timely detection and management, as some of them could be even fatal and increase morbidity and mortality. Now, with this, I would like to end my talk and would like to thank all of you for your patient listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you.